Welcome to today's Marketplace at the New York Stock Exchange. I'm Jane King, and today we are joined by Steve Vinsa, co-CEO of Tenable Incorporated, and Dr. Dustin Orman, a professor of business intelligence and analytics at the Hyder College of Business at Creighton University. So welcome, both of you. Great to have you here. Now, according to Barclays Investment Bank, AI is now the most important driver of growth in the world's largest economy, which is the U.S. But using AI opens up risk, of course, as well. So, Dr. Orman, what are the security vulnerabilities that we face as we start to develop and use AI more?
That's a great question. A lot of the vulnerabilities happen because agents now can do a lot of the things that people needed to have sophisticated skills to actually do. And now all you have to do is be able to plug something in and it could generate an output or a way to attack an organization or something like that. Additionally, when people take companies' information and plug it into these AI agents, they don't realize how much information they're giving away to these agents that could potentially compromise their information that could be leaked out to other companies and whatnot. So there's a lot of vulnerabilities with that that you got to be careful on how you actually use them. And
Okay. So now, Steve, as we all know, most companies use multiple cybersecurity tools to address their different aspects of risk exposure. How can companies cut through all that noise and address critical security threats?
A great question, Jane, and thanks for having me today. And at Tenable, our mission is to help organizations understand and reduce their cyber risk. And you're right, one of the big challenges for security teams today is not a lack of data, but how to manage an avalanche of data. So when I talk to security executives and CEOs and CIOs, they all tell me the same thing, which is they're drowning in alerts and they're starved for insights. In fact, the average security team has deployed over 80 different security solutions across the organization. And the reason why is because over the years, we've become a very digital society. And that has consequently expanded the attack surface and made us more susceptible to exploit. And think about today's IT environments. It's a sprawling ecosystem of traditional IT, servers, desktops, and laptops, as well as public and private cloud environments, IoT, not to mention identities, which both human and machine that have access to all of these systems. So cyber's a big challenge, it's very fragmented. And what also complicates problems is over the years, a lot of that technology, a lot of that investment in security has been on reactive detect and respond solutions. That means companies are actively looking for breaches and responding to them. 96% of all spend is in detect and respond. And what do we get for that? $10 trillion of cyber losses this year. So at Tenable, you know, we advocate exposure management, which is proactive security, to shift the focus from reactive firefighting to proactive fireproofing, which means we help organizations sort through all of the vendor sprawl, all of that noise, to help them identify the most critical vulnerabilities exposures on the most important machines that have the most sensitive data and identify likely paths of exploit.
Oh my goodness, it just feels overwhelming. Like every day you have to come in and fight this fight. So Dr. Orman, is the human user the weak link? I mean, we've kind of seen that in other breaches. Would you find that also in AI?
Yes, the human user is definitely the weak link because you could have a system that is very secure and all it takes is for people that work at the organization to be manipulated into giving information that they shouldn't or even granting access by clicking on a link. For example, all it takes is this simple crafted email message that has a specific link on a compromised server that could then be clicked and give full access to the credentials of a user or something like that. And so what you're trying to do is train your users to identify the messages that they should avoid. But the problem is now AI is generating these messages that are absent of those spelling check flaws that you used to see and all the other weaknesses that people have told you, look for these in email and that's an easy way to identify phishing. Well, that's not the case anymore because it could take, all these hackers have to do is put it through and say, generate this message, and then they have something that they can then use and send out. And so users need to be able to understand that they are the weak link to be able to protect their organizations despite all the security that's implemented.
Yeah. Steve, is this like the shadow AI that we're talking about here? And explain what that is exactly.
Well, it's a big problem in security. And by definition, shadow AI is the unauthorized use of AI tools and applications and even agentic capabilities by employees without knowledge from the IT staff or the security team. And it's not done maliciously. Employees are simply trying to use AI to do their job faster and be more productive. Now, this all seems seemingly harmless, but the challenge is that a lot of employees are prompting entering insights about corporate strategy, sensitive financial data or customer data, and even proprietary software code and intellectual property in these public AI tools that in aggregate have over 1.4 billion users in any given month. We're talking about tools like ChatGPT and Gemini. And so it's a big challenge in security, and these unauthorized tools have to be vetted. They have to have security guardrails. And so our role at Tenable is to help organizations discover shadow AI applications and then monitor usage, monitor prompts, and tie it back to security policies so organizations can manage risk.
Yeah, and it sounds like closing these gaps before they are exploited is 24/7 responsibility. So can AI tools be used to speed up the process of detecting AI vulnerabilities, AI to fight AI? Can you do that?
Yeah, yes indeed, and we're on this journey. But first, you have to know that threat actors are weaponizing AI to achieve incredible speed, scale, and efficiency. So we need to fight AI with AI, and AI can assess vast amounts of exposure data, talking about petabytes and even vast amounts of data, to deliver insights that humans are not capable of delivering. And they can do this in milliseconds. But we're on this journey, and it starts with discovering AI applications, understanding where they're vulnerable, understanding misconfigurations, and then also assessing the cloud environments in which these AI applications run in.
Okay, and Dr. Orman, what type of cybersecurity risks would a company be in if it were reactive versus had a proactive approach?
So when you're building out your environment, you need to consider all the security weaknesses. For example, I build a server that I use in my classes, and I have my students actually use it, and they can, I tell them, I actually give them extra credit if they can find some vulnerabilities on my site. And the reason why I do this is not so that I can give them extra credit, it's so that they can find those vulnerabilities so that other users do not attack and take advantage of them. So for a company, they also need to do the same thing, is have proactive approaches. And Tenable does a great job with some of the software that they offer to be able to actually scan your entire network, your entire servers, to be able to determine what those weaknesses are prior to actually any incident occurring, and then they can remedy those before they become a problem. And a lot in the past, cybersecurity has been more reactive, and we want them to be more proactive because the losses are becoming more substantial if we do not deal with the situation at hand.
Sure, I mean, just easier to prevent it.
Yes.
In all cases. So now, Steve, if AI is making cybersecurity more challenging, you know, what does that mean for mission-critical environments like critical infrastructure, power grids, things like that?
It's a great question, and we have to recognize that over the years, these industrial control systems were analog, then they became digital, and now they're all interconnected. So just think about like our power grids, our municipal water supplies, our telecommunication systems, manufacturing facilities, and even medical devices and equipment. They're all digital, they're all susceptible to exploit. And once threat actors have access to these systems, they can often move laterally to access other systems, and they can inflict great harm. So the stakes have never been higher, and you need to manage security holistically and proactively.
Yeah, so Dr. Orman, we've been discussing how to improve security around AI applications, but what about the risk of security while you're building an AI application, while you're in the process of doing that? So the time testing of new AI models is particularly a vulnerable time.
Yeah.
Right?
So there have been companies that have actually used these models, and they relied heavily on the models. And that's not necessarily a bad thing, but if you give access to these models to do things, to maybe have like full access, you don't know what you're granting to them. For example, there was a company that recently did this and actually had some specific constraints that were lined out for the AI not to violate these constraints. And what happened is it violated the constraints and actually wiped their database. And then it went a little bit further and bypassed those constraints even more and wiped all the backups. And so this company couldn't react or recover their information because they relied too much and gave too much authority to the AI agent to be able to do something like that.
That's when good old pen and paper come in handy sometimes, right? Like yeah. We should get rid of them. Steve, what should security professionals and also business leaders be looking at from a cybersecurity perspective right now?
Well, I think they have to recognize that the threat environment has never been as high as it has been today. We're seeing more breaches, more threats, more cyber incidents, and consequently more vulnerabilities. And we also have to recognize that, you know, AI represents a huge challenge. It's part of your attack surface. It has to be managed holistically. But there's no magic to AI. Usually a lot of these attacks, whether they're AI initiated or not, is usually a result of poor cyber hygiene. So companies should practice good cyber hygiene in the sense they should scan all internet-facing assets. They should use multi-factor authentication. They should limit access control so threat actors can't move laterally to minimize the blast radius. Good cyber hygiene, proactive security, certainly is really important to reducing risk.
So that's good advice. Is there any other advice you give for socially engineered attacks? And what do we mean by a socially engineered attack exactly?
It can be a number of different things. Number one, it means threat actors can use deepfake technology to greenlight fraudulent wire transfers. It means like they can craft flawless, hyper-realistic phishing emails that bypass both human suspicion and traditional email filters to access systems. So all of this means that, you know, there's more opportunity, and where there's opportunity, there'll be consequences and losses, and cybercrime is big business today.
And Dr. Orman, do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, so with the phishing messages and social engineering, what you need to do is second guess everything that you're going to do, because with those deep fakes that are out there, all that you need is a picture of someone and 3 seconds of their voice, and you can basically craft it to make it look like the person is actually saying what is being said, when in reality it's just AI that's been generated behind the scenes to actually run that.
Yeah. Okay, so as AI applications grow, Steve, and adoption grows, as we wrap up here, what kind of like tie in a neat little package, what advice would you give people, consumers, and businesses?
Well, we need to recognize that cybersecurity is not a technology issue, it's a business issue. And people need to recognize, executive C-suite board members need to recognize that cyber risk is business risk. And so we need to look at it in the sense that we need to look at risk holistically, we need to manage it proactively, and more importantly, we need to make sure that we understand how to measure and how to reduce risk. Eventually, where I'd like to see the market to go is not just reacting to breaches, not just proactive security, but autonomous risk reduction. There's incredible opportunity here, but obviously, we're in a new world today.
Yeah. Dr. Orman, are we equipping young people to be trained for cybersecurity careers and then also just to recognize in their own lives when something is a suspicious email, text, whatever?
Yeah, so first of all, with regard to your latter question, is that I encourage all users to second guess everything, right? And not just second guess, but second check. So for example, if someone reaches out to you via a phone call, you want to double check with another source, maybe an email or a text. If they reach out via text, reach out via video call. You can't just trust anything that's given to you. With regard to training the young professionals into the cybersecurity, there's still a huge need for it. There's a vast need for it. And so if anyone is interested in it, I encourage them strongly to get into it.
Okay. Steve, thank you so much. Co-CEO of Tenable and also Dr. Orman with Creighton University. Thank you for your important insight today.
You're welcome. Thanks for having us.
Thank you. And cybersecurity is such an important threat and very much we need to better understand this and how to address it. So thank you both for providing your insights today.
Thank you.
Thanks.